Hi, I'd like to welcome you to the news conference this morning, presented by a coalition that will be putting forward demands for release of the full Senate torture report. You have here a petition signed by in the neighborhood of 60,000 people. That petition will be presented in Washington to the relevant authorities later this week. This petition drive and this coalition effort is put forward by nine organizations: Roots Action, World Beyond War, Code Pink, the Bill of Rights Defense Committee, and Defending Dissent Foundation, Brave New Films, Daily Coast, Left Action, Progressive Democrats of America, and Demand Progress. We're going to be hearing from half a dozen speakers. And the first one of them this morning is John Kiriakou, a former CIA analyst. He's a whistleblower. He went to prison for publicly stating that the CIA had tortured. He's on the advisory board of Exposed Facts and co-chair of the Whistleblowers Public Education Campaign, sponsored by Roots Action Education Fund. John Kiriakou.
Thank you, Norman. We're here today for two reasons. One is to ask President Obama to release the Senate torture report in its entirety. And two, to warn the American people about what is coming next. First, Mr. President, please release this report. We implore you to release it for a number of reasons. First, it documents using primary source CIA information what kind of people we are, whether we like it or not. This report has to be a lesson for future generations. Let it teach these future generations what kind of people we must never be again. As Americans, we're better than what this report documents. Let it serve as a moral, legal, and ethical guide of what not to do in the future in our foreign and intelligence policies. Second, and I say this to the American people, know what is coming. The men and women that Donald Trump have surrounded himself with have told us that they're going to bring torture back as official government policy, and we ought to take them at their word. Let's look at history here. In 1946, the United States government executed Japanese soldiers who had waterboarded American prisoners of war. That was a war crime that warranted the death penalty. In January of 1968, the Washington Post published a front page photograph of an American soldier waterboarding a North Vietnamese prisoner. On the day that that photo was published, Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara ordered an investigation. The soldier was arrested. He was charged with torture. He was convicted, and he was sentenced to 20 years in a military prison. In 1988, the Deputy Director for Operations at the CIA testified before the Senate Intelligence Committee that the CIA did not employ torture because it was illegal. It's a violation of the Federal Torture Act. It's a violation of the United Nations Convention Against Torture, and it was just simply against the law. Well, that law didn't change. Torture was illegal in 1946, it was illegal in 1968, and in 1988. So why was it illegal in 2002, and why is it legal today? It's not, and it's not something that we should be in the business of doing. But torture is our future if we don't stop Donald Trump and those around him. We can do that by releasing this report. It's not too late. We have 10 days left. And I ask President Obama to do the right thing. Thank you very much.
We're going to have time for Q&A after we've heard from all of the speakers. Our next speaker is Carissa Miller. She's a campaign associate for Daily Coast.
Thank you. Hi. I am very proud to be here today to represent the Daily Coast community. Issues like this, being very clear about the history of the United States so that we can prepare for the United States that we want to see in the future, not being afraid of what has happened in the past, but learning from it and making sure that we're creating an America that looks like the America that we believe it is. And by having reports like this that are not released, that are not protected, that are not utilized appropriately to ensure that we move forward in a positive way is a shame. And right now, there are agencies that have this document, and they are not putting it into the Federal Register. It would be so easy for President Obama to ensure that this document is protected so that we can use it going forward, which, as we all know, is more important than ever, given the upcoming administration. And so by doing this, he can have his anti-torture legacy set in stone. He can make sure that we move forward in a way that all Americans want us to move forward. And he can send a clear message that we're not afraid and that we are not going to back down, although we have quite the administration ahead of us to deal with. Again, thank you so much for letting Daily Coast participate in this coalition. We are very, very happy to continue to do so. And we hope in the next 10 days to see real results from the over 60,000 Americans that have spoken up. Thank you.
Our next speaker is David Swanson. He's director of World Beyond War and campaign coordinator for RootsAction.org.
Thanks, Norman. There was a young man tortured in Chicago live on Facebook in recent days, and President Obama denounced it as a horrible crime. He didn't advise looking forward rather than prosecuting the crime. He didn't try to excuse it as possibly having some grander justification. He said there should be accountability. But for 8 years, he has forbidden prosecution of the crime of torture. And he now thinks that a report that is 4 years old should stay secret for at least 12 more years. A lot more can go wrong in 12 more years. That's not good enough. Agreeing with President Obama that there should be no prosecutions for torture was a man named Jeff Sessions. This is not the kind of bipartisan harmony the US public is looking for. As John noted, torture was a felony in the US code when Barack Obama moved to town. But not only has he refused to prosecute, he's gone through this pretense of banning torture, which convinces everyone it wasn't banned, and convinces everyone it's something a president can do or undo. And so now it's a policy choice, it's not a crime. And you have, as John said, Donald Trump coming to town promising to torture because it's a policy choice. This is the work of Barack Obama, and he can undo it. He can take a serious step for truth and accountability and the rule of law by making this report public now. Senator Feinstein says this report should be made public now. She does not have an ounce of the courage of whistleblowers in this country if she doesn't go ahead and make it public. She can read it on Capitol Hill with complete protection. She can choose to make it public at little to no risk to herself, and she should do so. And people would greatly respect her doing so. She says this report shows torture to be ineffective, contrary to Hollywood myths. Then let's see it. That's important, because this is what Donald Trump maintains, is he's going to come to town and use it because it is effective. And in fact, it's not just ineffective. It's far worse than that. It's been used to generate pro-war propaganda, to generate statements that Iraq is in league with Al-Qaeda. It's been used for sadistic purposes. It's been used for demonizing its victims before the US public. And it's been used to kill. How in the world can torturing people to death be effective? It's been used for human experimentation. This is the ugliness that needs to be exposed so we get beyond this silly debate over whether it's effective or not, which it clearly is not. But we need this document to put that before people. World Beyond War wants to end torture, also wants to end war. And this idea that we will someday have a torture-free war is absurd. If you have a war, you have these atrocities. You have the sort of atrocities we saw reported on at The Intercept this morning from SEAL Team 6. This is part and parcel of any war, and we should get beyond the idea that we can have a war without it. And if we're going to learn the real nature of war, we need to look honestly at what it is. We need to not bury the facts. We need to make this report public.
Our next speaker is Sue Udry. She's Executive Director of the Bill of Rights Defense Committee and Defending Dissent Foundation.
Thanks, Norman. Hi, everybody. The Bill of Rights Defense Committee and Defending Dissent Foundation is a now almost 60-year-old organization that is dedicated to ensuring that the promise of the Bill of Rights is fulfilled for everyone. Which is a long fight. So we need this torture report to be released. When he decided not to hold accountable Bush administration torturers, President Obama urged us to look forward, not back. And now we are looking forward, and we're worried, frightened, horrified at what we see, an incoming administration of men so depraved and ignorant that they openly proclaim their support for torture. These men need to read the torture report, and we need that torture report to be made public so that we can call out their lies and misrepresentations that torture works, that it isn't that bad, or that what was done in our name was not torture. We know Trump is morally vacant, and he's nominated a team of men who will back him up on that. Just take a look at Jeff Sessions. Who has consistently failed to oppose torture. He was one of only 9 members of the U.S. Senate to vote against a 2005 amendment barring cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment of detainees in U.S. custody. And again, in 2015, Sessions voted against torture prohibitions when he voted against holding the FBI and CIA to the same standards of interrogation laid out in the U.S. Army Field Manual, which forbids torture. So just think about that for a minute. Jeff Sessions is willing to give the FBI agents free rein to do what we don't even allow our armed forces to do on a battlefield. Mike Pompeo, nominated to be the director of the CIA, has doggedly opposed the release of the Senate torture report. In 2014, he said, quote, "These men and women are not torturers, they're patriots." Not in my book. Pompeo has also fought against closing Guantanamo. And although it isn't true, he has alleged that, quote, Gitmo has been a gold mine of intelligence about radical Islamic terrorism, end quote. And despite the lack of charges, indefinite detention, and horrible conditions that led prisoners to stage a prolonged hunger strike, which then resulted in gruesome, cruel, inhumane, and torturous force feeding of these prisoners, Pompeo has maintained that, quote, the detainees at Gitmo are treated exceptionally well, so well that some have even declined to be resettled, instead choosing to stay at Gitmo, end quote. President Obama and Senator Feinstein, we implore you to release the torture report so that we have a fighting chance to keep our country from going back and declaring torture official policy. Thank you.
Our last speaker before a Q&A is Charlie Varone. He's a professor of history at the New School, and he's here representing Witness Against Torture.
Thanks so much. And it's Jeremy Vron, by the way. That's fine. There's another Charlie Vron kicking around.
Who's, oh, sorry.
Yeah, pops up on the web before I do. Okay, I mean, first let me say that I'm very esteemed to be part of this panel and have tremendous respect for all the people who spoke before you. So I'm a member of, before me, I'm a member of Witness Against Torture. It's a group that's been working since 2005 to close Guantanamo and end torture. And the first thing I want to say is that I represent here the citizen voice. All too often, the torture saga is presented as a narrow beltway drama pitting the executive versus the courts, or Congress versus the executive, or Senate Democrats versus Senate Republicans, or even the Pentagon versus the president. But the issue far transcends partisanship or the distribution of power among branches. It speaks rather to the soul of the nation. And I want to say here today that there are millions of Americans who remain absolutely sick at heart at the unimpeachable fact that America tortured. And we remain disturbed and saddened that there has been nothing close to an adequate national reckoning with the country's grave crimes. Time itself does not heal this wound, and we have not let it go. Why should we? Now to the torture report. When it became clear that the United States abused detainees, there should have been investigations, indictments, and prosecutions to assign legal culpability. That's what the rule of law demands. It's the most powerful deterrent for such behavior happening again. But as the other panelists have said, Obama made the fateful decision not to pursue such action, in essence granting the Bush administration the power to rewrite laws to its own sinister ends. So we don't have on this issue the power and prestige of the law. There's been no accountability for perpetrators. There's been no justice for or apology to the victims. But we have at least one crucially and vitally important thing, the torture report. Its function is to burnish into the public record and the consciousness of the nation the sordid fact that America tortured, so that no one of any responsibility can either deny that it happened or claim that it worked. At least we can have the deterrence of this narrative. And then McCain and Feinstein in their introductions, you know, all but said this, that this is a kind of prophylaxis via storytelling in lieu of the law to prevent America from going down that dangerous path again. It took an act of courage to write the report. It took an act of courage to release the executive summary. And sadly, given the partisan climate, it will take an act of some courage to now do the right thing and release the full report, to again scream the facts that so many, including our new president, refuse to hear. Now more than ever, we need to affirm that torture happened, that it was ugly, that it can never happen again. And if it does, there should be real consequences. Now I want to close with a tragic, close with a comment more as a historian than an activist. I'm a professional historian. I teach at the New School in New York City. I find it tragic, infuriating, and ludicrous that there has been such entrenched opposition inside our government to releasing the full report. Manipulating and erasing the past is the stuff of fascists, totalitarians, and teapot dictators, not a proud democracy. It's time, as we have all said, for America to act in a way worthy of its own creed, you know, come clean about its own past and permit the democratic public, you know, the facts that allow it to make decisions in accord with the exercise of moral reason. That's what democracy is all about. And denying or hiding your own, you know, history is craven and dangerous, and we won't stand for it. Thank you.
And now we have some time for questions. Who has a question? There must be some here. Yes.
We heard mention of calls for President Obama to release the full report and for Dianne Feinstein to release the report. Am I correct in assuming that both have the power to release or read into the Federal Register the report? And are there others who also have the power or authority to release the report?
To restate the question for the video here, the gist is that this demand and the petition is for Dianne Feinstein and or the President Obama to release the full report. Are there others who also would have that capacity? Who'd like to respond to that?
Yes,
John Kariakou.
John, to the mic here. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Yes.
The president, of course, has ultimate declassification authority. He can declassify the entire report with the stroke of a pen. But any member of the Senate Intelligence Committee can insert the report into the congressional record, also in its entirety, and not face any legal consequences. They can make it an official congressional record and just release it to the American people. All they have to do is to schedule a hearing, either of the committee or of one of the committee's subcommittees, and say that they want to insert this as an official document in the congressional record. Unfortunately, so far, and the report's been out for quite some time, no one has had the guts to do that.
Other questions? Yes.
Yeah, it's not clear to me, is this report just about Guantanamo, or does it cover a range of other activities? I missed.
The question is whether this full report covers only Guantanamo or another range of activities. Who'd like to address that? David Swanson.
Well, John may want to speak to this too, but I believe it covers far beyond just Guantanamo. It covers torture at a number of so-called black sites and in Iraq and other locations in Afghanistan. And you can, in fact, read a 500-page summary of the 7,000-page report, 500 pages with lots of blacked-out stuff on it. But what we're asking for is the full 7,000-page report, which is described by Senator Feinstein as a completely different thing from the 500-page summary, and an overwhelming case that torture doesn't work on its own terms, which an incredible percentage of Americans have been persuaded in recent years by government propaganda and Hollywood films, Hollywood slash CIA films, et cetera, that it does. But it's certainly not just Guantanamo, but Guantanamo is a case where the CIA had a separate building, where it took people, and where it tortured them to death in some cases, and brought back bodies and pretended they'd hung themselves. And that is not what you see in the Hollywood CIA movies or television shows like 24. And if we're going to talk about torture and have debates about torture and have presidential candidates make campaign promises to torture, we ought to have a basic understanding of what we're talking about. And this report would have the authority and the weight to garner that sort of attention and persuade people of what those who've already looked into it already know, which is that beyond being illegal and immoral, it's counterproductive. It generates enemies and it doesn't work.
Just one other little question. Would it include the practice of transferring prisoners from U.S. jurisdiction to a foreign jurisdiction with the expectation that they would be tortured when they got there?
Well, that...
What was the word? Rendition, I think.
Rendition. Yeah. John may want to add to this. I do not know. I think it is focused primarily on torture by U.S. Staff. But yes, well, that's gone on for decades and has continued since the Nobel laureate moved into the White House. And this is the problem when you announce that you're ending torture. You announce that you're banning something that was a crime and thereby pretend it wasn't a crime. And forbid prosecution of it. It continues. And so we all talk about torture in the past tense and torture being brought back by Donald Trump, but torture has moved in the direction of being outsourced during the past 8 years, and that's nothing new.
But this report includes rendition?
I do not know.
Sure. I don't think any of us really know if it includes rendition. I would assume that it does, because the whole purpose of the report was to be the A to Z history of the CIA's torture program. You can't write that history without an accounting of rendition and what's called extraordinary rendition. There are legal scholars who will argue, and who have argued, that there's nothing illegal about rendition. If you are an Egyptian and you've been found in Al-Qaeda safe house in Pakistan, the Pakistanis don't want you. They ask the United States to send you back to Egypt. You're an Egyptian. There's nowhere else that you can go. However, if you are an Egyptian who's caught in an Al-Qaeda safe house in Pakistan and you're sent to Syria or Morocco or Algeria for some softening up, and then we'll see what you say in an interrogation afterward, that's clearly illegal. That's kidnapping, and it's a violation of any number of both U.S. and international laws. I personally believe that a full accounting of extraordinary rendition is contained in the torture report. I don't have any proof. That's just my gut. But I think that it's probably a prominent issue that's raised.
Are there any other questions? Okay. Yes.
This sort of cavalier comments, hi John.
Hi.
Do you feel that they're even grounded in any kind of, accurate assessment or from the intelligence community, or are they just sort of reactionary, sort of flipping, to maybe speaking to his base, or like, what was your response to them?
And just to summarize a question for the video, given the cavalier comments by the incoming president about torture, can we assess what the basis of that is in terms of any official reports? I think that's the gist of the question.
I think what we've heard so far from President-elect Trump is indicative of the ignorant, uninformed, misinformed president that we should expect in the next 4 years. It's my understanding that the president-elect has only been briefed a handful of times. Those briefings have not included the torture program. And I think that he is reacting to his own ill-informed gut, his own preconceived notion of what the torture report, or I'm sorry, what the torture program was supposed to have accomplished. He doesn't know any better. I hope that he's smart enough to realize that he's been wrong. I doubt that he is. And I don't think that especially John Brennan's CIA has urged Donald Trump to reinstitute this program. You know, John Brennan, for all his faults, and despite the fact that he lied to the American people about not having known anything about the torture program, at least has come out to say that it was wrong, it was a mistake, and it ought not be repeated. So I can't imagine that that same John Brennan would be urging the president-elect, or would allow his analysts to urge the president-elect to reinstitute the program.
And just quickly, if they do reinstitute the program, what kind of international backlash might there be? How would that affect the United States' credibility, for example?
I think that it would be very damaging to American credibility abroad. You know, so much of this program has already been made public. At least the skeleton of the program has already been made public. Most countries of the world don't want to have anything to do with this program. So where in 2002 we may have been able to pull a prime minister aside and say, listen, you have a base in the south of your country. There's a building on that base, and we really want to use it, and we don't want anybody to know we're using it. Where that may have worked in 2002, it's not going to work in 2017. The cat's out of the bag. and people don't want to be associated with this program. The only country in the world that is even considering bringing back torture is the United States. That has to stop now. So no, I think this is very much a Donald Trump thing. It's not the CIA pushing it on Donald Trump.
Just not to disagree, but just to add, I think that Donald Trump is also looking at U.S. public opinion. And if the U.S. public were overwhelmingly demanding an end to torture and overwhelmingly understood what Dianne Feinstein says this report shows, that torture does not work, if the U.S. public had not seen Zero Dark 30 and similar pieces of disinformation, Donald Trump would be impacted by that. And so releasing this report is not primarily because I think Donald Trump will read anything 7,000 pages long, but because I think it would impact the media and the public and public opinion and what it's possible to put into Hollywood movies. And that would in turn impact Donald Trump. There is some hope of that. But I think, you know, when the prosecutors in Spain were looking seriously at prosecuting U.S. officials for torture because the U.S. was not doing it, and people in the United States, including through a Roots Action campaign, were telling Spanish prosecutors, yes, go ahead, you know, that was stopped by the Spanish government. But there is going to be a vastly increased interest in such prosecutions by international bodies and by foreign courts under universal jurisdiction with Donald Trump. The world does not love and respect him enough to dissuade the momentum that's going to build for prosecutions elsewhere.
Are there any other questions? Yes.
Can you explain that stack of papers?
Oh, maybe I'll ask David to explain this stack of paper, which is the petition, and also what might become of it later this week. David Swanson.
This is a printout of names, towns, states, and comments. Around 60,000 people have signed this petition, and a good percentage have added comments, and some of them are quite eloquent and informative, and you can find all of this on the website. It's right at the top of rootsaction.org at the moment, or you can come take a look at this. But we are planning to hand this, if possible, to Senator Feinstein tomorrow, and again, ask her, as we are asking President Obama, to go ahead and make it public, which, as we heard from John, either of them could do. But there are people in other agencies and staff people who worked on the report who almost certainly could do so as well if they had the nerve and the decency. And we strongly encourage someone to be that hero and make that thing public. And we will appreciate them very, very much for doing so.
Okay, any last question here? Yes.
What do you think the most effective things are that the American people who are appalled by torture could be doing in their communities to raise this awareness?
The most effective things that people in the United States could do to have this awareness. Any comments from speakers?
Yeah, I mean, from a citizen perspective, this has been a tricky issue. I think it's incredibly disturbing for Americans to confront, you know, this ugly reality. And then there's a massive mechanism of psychological and political and moral denial. And then cutting through that has always been an extraordinary challenge. And then we and other public advocates have tried everything in the Democratic toolbox: petitions, marches, civil disobedience, calls to Congress, letters to Congress, you know, all but lighting our hair on fire. And then, as David said, arguably the country remains pro-torture. It's certainly pro-Guantanamo, according to public polling. And people in favor of keeping it open, that number has increased since Obama stepped into office. So bizarrely, there's still, you know, the absence of an accurate understanding of just what happened. So the challenge is a sustained campaign of public education, you know, events like this, you know, local action by people talking to neighbors and friends, schools, churches, synagogues, mosques, and then trying incrementally to build some consensus in the national memory. You're never going to get everybody that something horrible happened. And then the hope is that one day this is looked at like the internment of Japanese during World War II, or Indian removal, or Native American removal, or slavery, you know, and it's sort of morally stained. And then I've been working on this issue for 10 years, you know, trying to shut down what's become one of the most notorious prisons in the history of the world. It's quite profound when you think about it. Devil's Island, the Bastille, Auschwitz. It's not Auschwitz, but it's pretty terrible. You know, this will be in textbooks 100 years from now, if the planet's around. You know, and then we'll be able to say that when an extraordinary moral challenge was posed, like, we stood up and do the right thing, like some at greater risk, you know, than others. So it's important to do for the soul of the individual. It's important to take on as a national project. And I wish there were like an easy fix to the problem of denial and the kind of ignorance that Mr. Trump displays. But we won't let this go, because it, you know, can't be, you know, let go of. It's, you know, too important. And I should say that there's a demonstration tomorrow at the Supreme Court at 11:30, followed by some form of public action at the Senate buildings, where three Trump appointees are being, you know, vetted for confirmation. And then today was announced that, you know, over 100 retired generals and senior intelligence officials had sent a private letter to Trump urging that he not dust off the torture program. That kind of thing helps. And then oddly, you know, the national security establishment has taken some of the most forceful and principled positions on this. Not everybody, but, you know, some folks, and then that counts for a lot. So all levers of power in our democracy need to be pushed and yanked on. Thank you.
There are people deeply offended that the Clintons are going to celebrate with Donald Trump at his inauguration. What do they make of Barack Obama protecting Dick Cheney's legacy? What do they make of keeping out of public sight the work of someone like Dick Cheney, who is considered a respectable, non-criminal, free citizen coming in to advise the Trump administration on how to take the gloves off? Because we haven't gotten beyond that. You know, this, I would say, call the White House with that demand right now. Call Senator Feinstein's office. Call Donald Trump. Tell him to announce that he's going to make it public if they don't. And once he's president, if that happens, I still hope not, call him and tell him to make it public immediately. But go to your city council and get a resolution that says, we want this made public and we want prosecution locally. Go to your state legislatures. We want prosecution of torture if it's within our jurisdiction. Sign this petition at rootsaction.org. Write letters to the editor. Call radio shows. Do all the activist things. Build momentum for this. And the deadline of just having you know, less than 2 weeks to do it may help. Get people energized on the phones, on the emails, and making it news in the local news. And you never know.
So to look a little bit beyond the next 10 days, actually, I think the most effective thing that a lot of activists can do to fight the Trump agenda writ large is local action and ensuring that local police and local lawmakers are not complicit in pursuing the Trump agenda. What's been happening in North Carolina for probably about a decade, when local activists found out that a local airplane company was helping with the extraordinary rendition flights, they've been protesting at that airfield. They've been doing all sorts of local activities. And in Chicago, which has the unique distinction of police, a long history of police torture against citizens has created a torture-free zone in Chicago. So there's a lot of tools that activists can use locally that can push back against things that we fear that the Trump administration is going to pursue. And if, correct me if I'm wrong, John, but even after January 21st, any member of the Senate Intelligence Committee can still read the torture report and put it into the record. So so the fight will continue.
Before we close, are there any more comments from any of the speakers? Well, I'd like to thank everyone for being here and look forward to working with you in the future.